Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us. We're going to have a great program this afternoon. I am going to keep welcoming you all for a few minutes because we have so many registrants. I know it'll take a few minutes for you all to drift into our webinar. This afternoon, you're going to be joined by five of our head ambassadors. We're excited that they're here with Mr. Kim, our head of school. Before we get started, I just want you to know that they won't be speaking to the admissions process itself or be able to answer application questions. So if you have any of those for us, please give the admission office a call tomorrow. As well, our financial aid application deadline is also Monday, February 1st. And so if you're going to be applying for financial aid, you may want to tackle that this weekend. And as well, if you have lingering questions after the webinar, I hope you will absolutely call one of us. We don't want you to have any unfinished business before you finish your application. So again, welcome this afternoon to join us, our head ambassadors and our head of school, Mr. Ron Kim. Mr. Kim, I'll turn it over to you.
All right, thanks, Kim. Thanks so much. I really appreciate all of you joining us today. I know you have a lot of things to do, and for all of the parents and guardians and students out there, thank you so much for joining us. So we only have about a half an hour, and what we want to do is try to cover as much as we can to help you know as much as you need to know about the Bishop School and about what you can look forward to. So we're going to introduce the head ambassadors. I'm going to say a few words about where we've been, where we are, where we're going, and then we'll go through some questions and hopefully give you a real good glimpse into the school. So I'm gonna transition now quickly over to the students. I'm gonna ask them to just share their name, their grade, the grade that they started, and some of the activities in which they're involved on campus. So first, let's turn it over to Luca.
Hello, everybody. My name is Luca. Currently, I'm in the 10th grade. I've been at Bishop since sixth grade. And on campus, I'm a part of Model United Nations speech and debate team. I play soccer and tennis, and I'm also involved in the performing arts department.
Hi, everyone. I'm Maya. I'm a senior. I came to Bishop's in seventh grade. And a few of my favorite activities on and off campus are speech and debate, mock trial, refugee tutoring, soccer, and lacrosse. Welcome.
Hi, my name is Seiji. I'm a current junior at Bishop's. I came here in ninth grade, freshman year, and on campus, I'm involved with the boys water polo team. I'm a member of peer support, and I'm also the junior representative for the disciplinary committee.
Hi, I'm Angelina. I'm a junior. I came to Bishop's my freshman year. I'm a part of ASBC. I'm a member of the Black Student Union, and I also play girls basketball.
Hi, everyone. My name is Ryan. I'm currently a 10th grader, and I also came here in sixth grade. Some activities on campus that I'm involved in are water polo, swim team, and I'm also involved in theater arts.
All right. Thank you all. So one of the other things that you're all involved in, of course, is head ambassador, and we really appreciate that you do all of those things. And I'm always impressed by how many different activities our Bishop students do, and how involved and how much you enjoy all those different parts of the experience. So thank you all for doing all of that and also for being here, you know, with us. So for the applicants, prospective applicants and families, I just want to say a few words, you know, about where we've been and where we are and where we're going in the future. I know that this year has been a really unusual year, you know, very different from what you had hoped for or what you expected. And it raises a lot of questions that you may have for schools, including ours, about how we've managed during this really difficult time. So let me say a little bit really quickly about where we've been. So, you know, last March, like every other school in the area, we had to go to virtual learning. We went from in-person to virtual in 3 days, and our teachers did a remarkable job at continuing their dedication to students and figuring out how best to make sure the students continue to learn and meet their goals during a really quick transition. And then this fall, starting on September 2nd, we started to have some students on campus, you know, by grade level. But pretty much every day since September 2nd, we've had students on campus with rare exception. Today we had middle schoolers on campus, and then next we'll have 9th and 10th graders back on campus, and then grades 11 and 12 in rotating cohorts. Certainly we haven't had as many students on campus on a daily basis as we would hope. It's just so fun to have the students on campus. I think sometimes students don't realize how much it matters to us and how much happier we are when the students are here. I had a moment the other day where I was speaking with a colleague and we couldn't hear each other because there was so much laughter from students nearby. And that was, you know, that was like one of the highlights of the year for me. It's just one of those normal moments of hearing students just being delighted to be on campus. And so, you know, we're really happy with all of the measures we've taken this year that have enabled some of our students to be on campus. And as we look to the rest of this winter and spring, I think we'll see a couple of phases. I think we will have probably over the next few weeks, you know, continued challenges to try to make sure that we can have students here as safely as possible. And then with the greater distribution of the vaccines, I think the spring will be our light at the end of the tunnel. I think we're going to have increasing numbers of people on campus, and I hope that we can end the spring term with far more people on campus, return to so many of those rites of passage and rituals that we miss so much. But really for us throughout the year, we've had three primary goals that we've tried to achieve. One is we wanted continuity of learning. Our students are very self-driven. They love to learn. If they don't feel like they're continuing to learn, I know you start to get edgy. So we've really been committed to making sure that we continue to meet you where your passions are. And our teachers have done a really extraordinary job of figuring out different ways to meet those same educational goals. Another goal, of course, has been to be safe. We wanted to make sure that this campus was a safe place to be during this pandemic. You know, I had a teacher, it's funny, it's one of your math teachers. He's older, but he still talks to his mom. And his mom was wondering if it was safe for him to teach from campus. And so he said he told his mom that there's no place that's safer to be outside of his home than the Bishop's campus. And I hope you feel the same way when you're on campus too. And so we've been very focused on trying to be safe. And the final thing that we've been mindful of is the social and emotional well-being of students. We know that it's really hard to not be on the campus, to feel like you're learning from a screen as often as you've had to do. And so that's why we've been committed to trying to have students on campus as much as possible, because we know you're happier doing that. We know when you see each other on campus, that's so much better. We know when you get to go to the dining hall for one of Ms. Sweet's lunches, that's so much better probably than what you're slapping together at home. So we've been trying to make sure that we have those combinations and make sure we do as much as we can in each of those areas so that you're learning, so that you're safe, and so that you're happy. And so that's really been our focus for next year and beyond. So I think the fall looks bright. I'm really optimistic about the fall. And it's not just me, all of the people from the CDC and other health organizations that I read, you know, tell me that I can be optimistic about the fall. Yeah, I'm a history guy, and I've learned more about science probably the last few months than I ever had learned before. But from what I've learned from my crash course, I think the fall and beyond, we're going to return to something pretty close to normal. And I know that after we get through COVID, we also get to think about other things that we care about in education and schools. So, you know, we've been working while working on the day-to-day of COVID planning and instruction. We've been working on a strategic plan. And what I'm happy to share, you know, right now in our thinking is very focused on the student experience. You know, that's what the schools are here for, is to maximize what the student experience is. And so for me, there are some really important preconditions of what makes great learning possible. So at the core, what I'm thinking about is student well-being. And it's not just the COVID thing. It's, you know, how do we make sure that kids are well, that they're happy, that they're able to feel like they can really thrive here. And that's something that I was thinking about for years. And that's really the core of my thinking. And I think one of the silver linings to COVID is that I think everyone is far more attentive now than they would be in normal times to well-being, because they know that this can be a period that can be really hard for kids. And so I think, good, let's all agree that well-being is at the center of any good learning experience. If you're not well, it's hard to learn. So that'll be a real focus for us. Another layer of that's foundational is a feeling of belonging. When you come to this campus, you should feel like, this is my school. You should think, I love this place. I can be who I wanna be. And I can learn in the way I wanna learn, and I love the people I get to be in school with. And that feeling of belonging just makes you feel so eager to learn, so happy to be here, makes you feel like, I love school. And I know as parents, there's one thing you want. You want your kids to say, I love school. And they're gonna love it so much that you're gonna wonder why they're never at home. That's okay. That's okay. That's good for their development. And so that feeling of belonging is another crucial foundation. I also want us to be real leaders in knowing about adolescent growth and development. And what I mean by that is I want us to be a school that's structured around the way adolescents learn and develop. And that might sound like an obvious thing, but schools are often structured for lots of reasons that are not just about the way students learn and grow. And I want us to be real leaders in that. I want us to understand the neuropsychology of adolescent development and learning and make sure that our classes, that our teaching, that our schedule, our advising, extracurriculars, all those things are structured in ways that students learn best. And the final thing I want us to be thinking about is why we're here. Why is the school here? And it's for development of some sense of purpose. All the time that we spend learning and growing and developing, it's not just for us. It's so that we have some sense of purpose, that we're here so that we can be of service to others. And the students here over time will understand that there's some things that they care about that are beyond them. And that's empowering. That makes you feel like you're not just trying to get a grade. You're not just trying to get a score on an exam or get into a particular college, but you think you have some greater purpose in your life. And that makes it all really rewarding and worthwhile, because you know that there's something more to all of this. So, all right, so that's enough for me. That's what I wanted to say about where we've been, where we are, and where we're going. It's so fun for me to talk about this with people. I really wish we were in a room together so we could talk about it. But as we know, this is the next best thing. So, all right, I'm gonna stop right there. And we have some wonderful students with us. So I want to give them a chance to answer some questions that we received from you prior to this session. I know many of you sent in some questions. I found a few that I thought probably pertain to a lot of different potential applicants. And so I wanted to make sure that we had time for that. So are you all ready? All right, so here's some questions for you. The first one, what are some fun ways the teachers engage with students outside of the classroom?
Oh, I could spend hours talking about this. I think one of the most beautiful parts about Bishops is that you really get to know your teachers and your faculty members. I can give you a few examples just to kind of give insight into what a typical relationship looks like for a Bishop student. I became very close with my history teacher, Dr. Holland, who I had first in sophomore year for AP European History, and then again in junior year for AP Art History. AP European History was a journey. It didn't come as easily to me, but our relationship grew the next year. And it was so much fun to kind of grow both as a student and as a as a friend, honestly. We're currently planning to get dinner after COVID is settled. She's become one of my dear friends on and off campus. One of the things she did with our class, obviously it's not a class requirement, but since it is an art class, we went to the San Diego Museum of Art, where she took myself and one other student on a personal guided tour. And honestly, I can't think of any better way to enjoy art than being taught by your teacher who knows more than anyone else you could ever ask. There's hundreds of other examples, and I'll kind of let the floor go to some of my peers here. But yes, that's one perfect example.
Yeah. Thanks, Maya.
Continuing, one thought that I have is throughout middle school, one way the teachers interact with the students outside of the everyday classroom is the sports teams, the middle school sports teams. I remember 6th through 8th grade, I would be in class, and then right as the bell rang, I would go get changed. And I would see those same teachers out on the field or on the basketball court or by the pool. It would be very fun to hang out with them in kind of two separate worlds and see and build a relationship outside of just, you know, learning from them in the class and getting to learn from them out on the field.
Yeah, building off of both Ryan and Maya, one of the things I've missed the most during COVID times is being able to just walk around campus and those random encounters you have with any of the faculty members, any of my early teachers I had freshman year, sophomore year, walking around campus, bumping into them, talking for a bit, seeing what's new and everything. That's been a great thing about Bishops and really this open campus feeling that up until even after school ends, there's office hours and extended periods of time where teachers leave their classrooms open always. And you can knock on the door, come in, talk about schoolwork, but everyone's also there to support you for whatever you may need. And talking to my advisor, for example, Ms. Broderick, who's also a school counselor, helps a bunch. So all the classrooms are always open, and that's what I enjoy the most about Bishops.
Exactly. Like one of my favorite, like all-time favorite activities is the student faculty basketball game. And we do have that every year. And, you know, students, I'm pretty sure we win all the time, most of the time, you know. We do slip up occasionally, but yeah, it's so fun. We see the competitive side of the teachers, you know, and you can tell that they really care about us. They really care about our well-being. They want us to be, to feel like we belong, like Mr. Kim said earlier. And I really get that sense when I'm at Bishops.
Teachers are also involved in hosting clubs because each club needs a host in their classroom during regular years. And so not only can you engage with the members of the club, but also with the teacher who's hosting it. And I know a specific example of somebody in the Zoom room, Mr. Donald, was in a play, Romeo and Juliet, a couple years ago, which my brother was also in. And so this was kind of like a special play that they had with a bunch of faculty and students, both of them. And he told me a bunch of stories, my brother did, about the fun times he had, especially with the faculty and staff, because this was something that hadn't really happened before. But yeah, it's definitely a focus at Bishops for teachers to have fun outside of the classroom and build connections with students.
All right, thanks all. Next question. From your years at Bishops, what are you most proud of?
I can go first. Definitely the relationships that I've built so far. I can tell that they're not like temporary. I know I'm gonna definitely continue to pursue these friendships that I've made, and also the life lessons that I've learned, you know, in the classroom and outside the classroom. So
yeah, I really have to echo what Angelina just said. I think it's a lot of it is about relationships built with both your peers and your teachers. Additionally, I think Bishops really focuses on engagement, whether that's inside or outside the classroom. And I think getting involved in a lot of things has helped me just even in my life as an everyday person. You know, it's not just about my activities in the classroom, but it's also about how I interact with the world around me. And just getting involved is the first step in that. And Bishops really helped kind of build the foundation for even getting interested in trying new things in the first place.
Yeah, going off of the idea of engagement, Bishops is a place of many opportunities, and oftentimes they're presented to you, but you can also take those opportunities and be able to enrich the Bishops campus. So throughout my time at Bishops, I've been able to bring several very close family friends. A friend of my grandfather's is one of the very few surviving Japanese members of the bomb, the atomic bomb. And sophomore year, I was able to talk with him and invite him to the Bishop's campus and have him speak to my fellow classmates who were learning European history at the time. And those very enriching opportunities have always been something I've cherished at Bishop's.
Adding on, I think that's probably the key here, taking the advantage of the vast amount of opportunities that Bishop's offers. A specific example I can give you guys is last year in ninth grade when I took this class called Intro to Speech. It was an introduction to the speech and debate team. And I probably wouldn't have really ever gotten into speech and debate if it wasn't for Bishop's. And fortunately, a couple months ago, I was able to go to a tournament where I gave a speech on a topic about any United States foreign or domestic policy, any piece of news in the United States, and you have 30 minutes to prepare a 7-minute speech in front of judges. And I did the best I've ever done before. I got third place in front of a bunch of varsity guys. But if I wasn't able, if I wasn't even offered the opportunity of speech and debate, I probably wouldn't have even gotten into it at all. Outside of school, etc. And yeah, that's probably the key here.
All right, so one of the things I really appreciate about your answers is how much a question about what you're proud of was less about yourself and more about the relationship with others in the community. And I think that's a really unique response and says a lot about what makes this place what it is. So you know, thanks for that. Now, how do you ensure that there's healthy and respectful debate in these volatile times? And I think maybe the question is about, you know, politically volatile times. How do you have healthy and respectful debate?
I can start with this one. I think the first step, especially in these times right now, is you have to be able to acknowledge that, you know, not everyone's going to have the same opinion as you every single time. But the biggest thing is it's, you know, I think disagreement is good because it can lead to more deeper understanding of the conflict at hand. But at the same time, I think the way I personally handle that is you just can't let these disagreements get in the way and interrupt the relationship you have with the person you disagree with. And at the end of the day, I think it's important. And I think all of my peers at Bishop's, I don't agree with all of them all the time, but we always move past that. And the relationship is not injured by these disagreements.
Yeah, I mean, as everyone recognizes, Bishop's is an incredibly diverse community. And I think one thing that we've started this year that's been incredibly helpful in fostering these talks and discussions is DEI. And that's our diversity, equity, and inclusion discussions that we have in our advisories. My advisory, I feel like, is a perfect example of Bishop's, if you could just take a really, really small sample size. We have people on very opposite sides of the political spectrum. And we're able to have incredibly productive discussions with each other. And obviously, there's no better time than right now to have these discussions, given what's going on in the world. And it builds incredibly useful skills because you're able to communicate with other people who may not have the same outlook on life that you do. And you're able to still have these really productive discussions and grow and learn together, which I think has been really helpful.
And the school has definitely done a great job of, you know, merging this DEI into our Zoom school environment. The easiest thing right now, where discussions can get dangerously, you know, polarized, is when you're sitting behind a screen and people don't see your face and you can kind of just say whatever you want. So DEI has really allowed people and advisors to really talk face-to-face to, you know, members like Maya said that you might not really agree with, but being fine in disagreeing and starting those discussions is really the most important thing right now.
Exactly. Like, I feel like the reason why DEI is so successful is because we are giving both sides of the argument a voice. You know, we're allowing them to be heard. We're listening. I feel like that's just the important part, just listening. You might not agree, but just understand where the person is coming from, or at least try to, is just totally key.
Yeah, I remember earlier in this year, there was a series of 4 DU posts on affirmative action, which was on the California ballot. And I remember the first student posted an opinion piece opposing the affirmative action bill. And that led to a series of back and forth dialogue that was so interesting and so well informed. And you know, I learned a lot from it. And I think the thing I was most impressed by, well, was the level of thought that went into it that was not personal it wasn't overly political, but it was just trying to get to the best solution that the society could reach, right? So I was really impressed by that. All right, how are we doing on time? So we only have 6 minutes. So I had one more question for you, but maybe we should go to the questions you have for me. Would that be all right? All right, so let's do that.
What is your favorite Bishop's school tradition or event that you experienced so far?
There are a few that I have in mind, but one of the things that I really appreciate is the signing of the Great Book. So all the students who are new to school will line up at St. Mary's Chapel, and you know, I'll have a big book, and they'll write their names into the book for their class year. And it's one of those things that, you know, you're always forever going to be a bishop's student. And I love the ritual of that. I love the sense of place that comes with it. This year, we had the Great Book signing. It was in a slightly different order because of the COVID restrictions, but there was one student from who I think was the only new student for his advisory group. And so he went in, he signed the book, and when he came out, there were balloons and a standing ovation, you know, for him because he was now in the Great Book. And so I just love that tradition. And it's reflective of this place being here for a long time with deep tradition, but it's renewed every year with new students. Oh, Francis is taking credit for that advisory. Okay, all right. Good job, Francis. All right, what's the next question?
Our second question was that since you are still, since you're relatively new, how did you get to know the school and the students coming into Bishop's?
So being around the students is the best part of the day for anyone who loves being in schools. And so part of it for me was just trying to be wherever the students were, you know, whether that's going to plays or games or hanging out at lunch or milk break. And beyond that, one thing I try to demonstrate is I'm willing to do the same things that you're trying to do. So, you know, and when I first started, I joined a football practice, pulled a muscle in the process of doing it, but that was all right. You know, I healed. I did boy band. I did seventh grade dance. I played water polo. And those were the ways for me to just, be in the same mix with the students, put myself out there. But one thing that I say to adults all the time is being a student is a daily, vulnerable, courageous experience. You know, we ask you every day to do things that you're not sure how to do yet. And you know, we sort of think that's normal because that's what happens with students. But as adults, we forget that sometimes. And I have a lot of respect for students who do that every day. You know, we always ask you to do things that you can't quite do yet. And so for me, I wanted to do that as well. Just put myself out there, do the things that you're doing. And I felt like I felt a bond with the students in doing that. And beyond that, I just love hanging out with students, having little chit-chats at volleyball games or basketball games, and just hearing how things are going for you.
And our final question for you, Mr. Kim, is we understand how you met with all of the senior class last year, and did they have any parting words for you?
Yeah, that was so fun to do. I had exit interviews with different senior advisory groups, and there are a couple of things that I remember were themes. One of the things I asked them about was, you know, what was more than you had expected? What was better than what you had expected? And I think every group talked at some level about their relationships with their teachers. But I remember one of the ways that they put it was, you know, they remember being on the applicant side and listening to people like you, right, talk about what it would be like as a Bishop student. And what they said was they were told that they would have these great relationships with teachers. And they said, it wasn't until they got here that they understood what that meant, how profound that relationship was. And they, there are variations of the comment, I can't believe how much the teachers cared about me. They had never felt anything quite like that. And that was a consistent theme throughout all of those conversations. And then I asked them a little bit about what they wish they'd had more of. And one thing that they said that they always appreciated so much at Bishop's was with those moments of unstructured time, milk breaks, lunches, time between practices, those spontaneous occasions where they just got together and hung out with their friends at Bishop's. Because it's such a great community. It's so many people who share so much in common in their values and their interests. And every moment that they had where they could just hang out with their friends at Bishop's, they really cherish those. And so, you know, at the same time, you have a lot of goals you're trying to achieve and practices and games and classes. But those moments where you just could chill and hang out and you know, with your friends, they thought those are the best moments. So that's what I remember from those conversations. But it was a really great senior class, and it was so fun to talk to them and have them reflect on the year. So we're a little bit over time. So I know that there are probably some individual questions that some of you have been writing in. I know that Mr. Donald has been keeping track of those, and we'll be able to get back out to you. I think your application deadline, if you haven't submitted it already, is Sunday. And if you have any questions about those things, feel free to talk to Ms. Cooper. But I really hope that this time helped you just get a sense of what being a student here would be like, what the students are like, you know, what we care about here as a school. And I think we have this tremendous balance here of really caring about learning, really loving doing that, and also a really caring and humble community. You know, I think as Ryan was saying, you know, no one here feels like we've got it all figured out, but you know, we really enjoy doing going through the process together. So, you know, thank you all for taking the time. Thank you, Head Ambassadors. Really fun to see you and to take part in this conversation with you. So, all right, good luck, everyone. And we hope to see you next year. Okay, all right, bye.